everyone. Good to see you here. It's a beautiful day, a little cold, but we'll get over it. Anyway, what I want to talk to you today, I'll be brief. This is something that I've been thinking about for the past few days. And I started looking up some scriptures regarding this. A few days ago, I started watching the last season of The Voice. I don't know if you're familiar with the program. And some of these guys, they're good. You know, their singing and their range and their vocal diversity, it's really amazing. And I started thinking about this in terms of the talents that we have from God. You know, every single one of us has something that we're good at, or a few things that we're good. And I started looking at some scriptures that will kind of like reinforce this for me that I've been thinking about. And I want to start by reading from James chapter 1, verse 17. It says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. The next scripture that I want to read is 1 Peter chapter 4. Verse 10. It says, as each has received the gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Now, a lot of people think that there's only one way that we can give back. And I've always thought that that's not necessarily true, because that's the reason why we're all so different, and we all have these skill sets and these things that we're good. And there's so many different ways that we can actually give back and still honor God, you know, because of those things that He has given us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 5 and 6, it says, and there are variety. No, I'm going to start with verse 4. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. I have been blessed with the ability to sing, but I have never used this gift that I have in front of other people, because I've always been very self-conscious. The only place that I actually feel comfortable doing it is here, which to me tells me a lot, because what better way to use this talent that God has given me to honor Him, you know? So some of you can draw or paint, you know, like the girls. They drew me a picture one time. Thank you very much for that. That's a gift that God has given them. You know, other people, they are really good teachers and bringing message to others. Others are really good at speaking and being able to share a message in a cohesive way, which I'm not doing a really good job right now, that is easy for others to understand and relate to and be able to see some things that they were unable to see before, that will shed some light, the light that is shining through us, God's light to others, so that they can come and know Him and see Him and know who He is. Romans chapter 12, verses 4 through 8, it says, for as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, in proportion to our faith; if service, in our serving; the one who teaches, in his teaching; the one who exhorts, in his exhortation; the one who contributes, in generosity; the one who leads, with zeal; the one who does acts of mercy, with cheerfulness. Whatever gift that you have, that the Lord has given you, just embrace it and look at it as, if way that I'm going to honor God. So I'm going to work really hard and becoming good at this and use it to the best of my ability so I can help other people. Or if they need encouragement, I can encourage them. If they need some help because they are sick and they need to be taken care of, I can take care of them. If they need direction, I can lead them. I can teach them. I can show them things that for some reason or another, they would not be able to do these things. First Corinthians 16, verse 14. It says, let all that you do be done in love. You have the gift, you have the talent, use it. But everything that you do, do it in love. Mm-hmm. Because what is God? He is love.
Yes.
So everything that we do should reflect who He is. And we should be grateful and we should be happy, joyful, cheerful. And the last scripture that I want to share to close this, Psalms 150. It says, praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens.
Yes, Lord.
Praise Him for His mighty deeds.
Yes, Lord.
Praise Him according to His excellent greatness.
Yes.
Praise Him with trumpet sound. Praise Him with lute and harp.
Mm-hmm.
Praise Him with tambourine and dance.
Yes.
Praise Him with strings and pipe. Praise Him with sounding cymbals. Praise Him with loud clashing cymbals.
Yes.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
If you can dance, if you can sing, if you can teach, if you can take care of someone, if
yes.
you can talk to people,
yes.
if you can draw, if you can paint, if you can direct someone, anything that it is that you can do, that it is a gift from God, use Him with love to help others and praise Him
mm-hmm.
as you go along.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Any prayer requests or testimonies this morning? Yes, Mike.
Send us here.
Yes. Yeah, Sally.
Yeah, I want to share kind of along with what you're talking about. What each one of us are capable of doing after we receive the Lord and our relationship grows within us. I was listening to WHO the other day, and they were talking about what you were discussing on Wednesday night, praying for somebody else, or if they say something, you know, I have this issue. And we just automatically say, I'll pray for you, or let's pray right now, or whatever. But they're trying to make a law now in the workplace. I don't have a job. But for those that do, that's where we're going, that you can't even speak and say, I'll pray for you, because people find it offensive. Well, I find it offensive that they wouldn't want a prayer.
Mm-hmm.
But then about an hour or two later, I was in Hy-Vee. And ran into Tammy's cousin, and we stood there for an hour and a half, and we discussed the grace of God, and everybody could hear us. We weren't quiet about it in any way, and it was so awesome to be able to do that, and there's nobody that's going to tell me that what I feel inside, and I want to share that I can't do it, when they can share whatever they want to about ball games, about
some of these pictures that are made with with many different faces, and as you start zooming out, all of a sudden, all of those little things come together and form just the one thing,
uh-huh.
and it's just one big image. That's just how we are. Every single one of us in this world, whether a believer or not, we have all been chosen. We need to make the decision to accept that and follow God, to come to Him and receive His blessings.
Amen.
He loves us regardless, but
Amen.
Every single one of us all put together, when He looks at it zooming out,
mm-hmm.
all He sees is Christ.
Yes, that's right.
Yes,
the big
that's
picture.
Awesome.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Anyone else? James.
Pray for each other. It's a body of Christ.
Father, we thank you this morning for everything that you do for us.
Thank you, Jesus.
We thank you, Lord, for your word that you give us, to edify us, to build us up, Lord, to instruction, to direct us.
We
thank you, Heavenly Father, for every good and perfect gift that you give us, which we know come from you. We thank you, Father, for giving us all of these wonderful talents and things that we are able to do so we can help others, bring joy to others, and show them who you are. Father, we pray for all of those that are sick. We declare right now, Lord, that your healing is manifesting as we speak. And we declare that, Lord, believing that you have said that it is finished. And we declare that in your mind, in Jesus' name. Father, we pray for all of those that are in situations that they need some direction, they need some clarity. They need to know what it is that they should do. And we know, Lord, that your Holy Spirit is always there to steer us back into the path that you have laid in front of us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Father, for those that are right now in need of some sort of medical procedure to be done. We declare that you will give the doctors the wisdom to take care of the situation, and you are going to glorify it along the way, that everything goes according to your plan, your will, and purpose. We thank you, Father, for all those that are in difficult situations, Lord. They feel like they're trapped. You give us freedom, Father. So when we come to you, we know that we are free. Thank you, Father, for everything that you show us, for choosing us to be your children, for declaring us your children, Lord, and loving us the way that you do. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for bringing us together here today to hear your word, to share this testimony with one another, to receive encouragement, to be an encouragement to one another, Lord. We thank you because we know that you are in this place right now. Okay, this coming Friday, Tom Stanton is going to be here at 7. If you are able to come, do you have anything to add?
No, come get a fresh word from the Lord. I'm praying that Tom not only brings the prophetic word, but he also leaves the helps under people understand that they too also, being all priests and servants of the Lord, that they also have the gift of prophecy.
That's right.
So yeah. The things that he does isn't isolated just to him.
That's right.
We're all called to do these things.
Amen.
So
amen.
You come observe and see how the Lord works through him, and not just receive from the Lord through him, but also understand that the Lord wants to work through you in that same way.
That's right.
Amen.
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 All right, well, let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that
thanks for another time, Lord God, to be here with the fellowship of your truth and word and your love. God, that you just had your way here today and you're blessing on this offering. You just multiply, God, and bless the people as they give unto you. And we want to lift you up. And God, we just pray that you have your free way, Lord God, to do what you will in your mighty spirit, just not being hindered by anything, but opening our eyes and our hearts to your blessed truth in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's worship the Lord.
Oh, how beautiful are you, Lord? It's your words, it's your love. Oh, how glorious are you, Lord? It's your power, it was your cross that saved me and rescued me. Just a moment there set me your words and it's your love. Oh, how glorious are you, Lord? It's your power and it was your cross that saved me and rescued me. Just a moment there set me free. You became my king forever, and with a crown of thorns,
yes.
You became my king forever, and with a crown of thorns, you became my king forever, and with a crown of thorns, you became my king forever, that saved me and rescued me. Just a moment there, it set me free. That saved me and rescued me. Just a moment there, it set me free.
That saved me.
That saved me and rescued me. Just a moment there. Set me free, that saved me and rescued me. It set me free.
Give you glory.
I give you glory, glory.
I give you glory, glory.
I give you glory, glory.
Last chance to get that roof loosened up. Hallelujah, Lord.
Power of the grave, constant and the trial and the change. One thing remains, one thing remains. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. One. fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love, your love, your love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Oh, I heard a thousand stories of what they think you like, but I you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. Who you are. Who you are, and I'm loved by you. I'm loved by you, Lord. I'm loved by you, Lord. You are the perfect God. You are the perfect God. You are the perfect.
Lift up your voice in love on the Lord. Just lift up your voice, church.
Hallelujah. Worthy of our praise. Abba Father. Abba Father. No one loves me like you, Lord. For answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you can provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say. Oh,
It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's love Him right now. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We love you because you first loved us. Thank you, Jesus, that your love does never fade. It never changes. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. God of love, our Father. Hallelujah. Our Lord and our King. We bless you and praise you right now. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're doing, what you've already done in this service, what you'll continue to do by your Spirit. Hallelujah. We trust you, Lord, because you are a good and a mighty God, and there's none like you. Everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Give him a hand clap this morning. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you all for being here. Praise the Lord. I was thinking while people were sharing their testimonies and we're talking about the body of Christ and how it works, I think sometimes kind of like the mechanic I went to once with an old car I had. He said, if I can be of any help to you, you're in more trouble than I thought. Praise the Lord. And supposed to fix my brakes, and I came back to pick it up, and he said, I couldn't fix your brakes, but I made the horn louder. And sometimes we settle for less than what we're really capable of. As in Christ, we can do all things.
Yes.
Nothing's impossible. Amen. We are more than conquerors. Hallelujah. We are victorious. We're more than conquerors because He has done more than enough. Amen. To make us victorious in every situation. Praise the Lord. And I just think that we're living in a time when the body of Christ really has to rise up and be who we really are. And I don't mean this in a confrontational way, as my wife would like to attack anybody who doesn't go, I'm just kidding, amen. But sometimes you just got to, you know, step up and be who you are and do what you do. And I think that, you know, as we go on in these last days before the return of the Lord, I think that we're going to have to really operate by the power of the Spirit. And I believe that's what the Lord is bringing us to. I think that's what a lot of what we've been learning through the Word of God is to help us to understand that there's nothing more that we have to do to be empowered by the power of God, by the Spirit of God. He did it all. We just have to receive it and then step out in faith and act on it. Praise the Lord. So that's what I want to talk to you about for a little while this morning. And if we can, Sheila, I've got a lot of scriptures for you, so I hope you're wearing your carpal tunnel wristband and do the best you can. Praise the Lord.
Technical difficulty back here, so I don't know.
That could be a problem. Praise the Lord.
All right, go ahead.
Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 9. We just believe God. Amen.
Amen.
And if not, we just, it's all right here. We can look it up if we have to. Praise the Lord. Just takes a little bit longer sometimes. So knowing therefore that the Lord thy God, He is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love Him, and keep His commandments to 1,000 generations. How many of you know that Jesus kept all the commandments? He fulfilled the law so that we are now accepted, amen, in the beloved. So here's what we need to know, that God is God, and He's a faithful God, and He keeps covenant and mercy with them that love Him and keep His commandments to 1,000 generations. That'd be us. So He's not going to stop keeping His promises. He's not going to stop keeping covenant, amen, with His people. Praise the Lord. All right, Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 6. Now that he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. Speaking of Jesus, amen, when God robed himself in flesh and came here, he began to put into place a new covenant. That new covenant actually was enforced after the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. We've moved from the covenant of law into the covenant of grace. We're into a covenant more like, but even greater than the covenant God had made with Abraham, which was simply based on believing God and then being declared righteous as a result of that. So we have that covenant. We still have the Abrahamic covenant, but we have an even greater and better covenant, one that has completely satisfied the demands of law and justice.
Yes.
Amen. And declared us to be innocent and therefore heirs of God. Praise the Lord. So this is established on better promises, even better promises than that they had in the past. Amen. So let's go to Hebrews now, 11:11. Again, I just mentioned that the Abrahamic covenant was not a covenant of law. It was 400 and some years before. Actually, it was about 600 and some years before the law was instituted. But it was a time when God dealt with man based on their belief in God. If you believe God, you were declared righteous. This is what happened with Abraham. So through faith, also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Now I want you to see, the reason this happened wasn't because of anything Sarah did, other than she believed that God was faithful, that what God said, he would do it. She didn't do anything other than believe that. And because she believed that, a supernatural miracle took place in her life. And we're all benefiting it from the results of that faith, that belief in God. Now, it wasn't like she had perfect faith, because we know she even laughed at the possibility when she was in the tent and God was talking to Abraham about it, and he even laughed. So it isn't, we're not talking about, you know, there's no beyond a shadow of a doubt. No, we're talking about believing God, not believing in my faith, not believing that my faith is great enough, but just simply believing that what God said he's going to do, because he's God, because he's faithful. Amen? So what I want to talk to you about this morning is believing or reasoning. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. This treasure that's in earthen vessels is Christ in us, the hope of glory. And that believes. He believes all things. The Spirit has no problem believing God. But our humanity, our flesh, wants to reason everything out. So we're constantly in conflict. Amen, because on the one hand, we believe God, because he's God. But our natural mind wants to reason everything out. It wants to look at the circumstances. It wants to look at the condition. It wants to look at the doctor's report, the lawyer's report, the attorney, you know, whoever. And then try to make some kind of sense out of that and expect it to come to pass. Sarah had been barren all of her life. This wasn't just a question of her being old and past the age of childbearing. She was always past the age of childbearing. She was never able to have a child from her youngest days, when she would have been the most fertile. Amen. So this was a lifelong situation that she was in. And yet she believed God, and she had a child. Not just because she was barren, but because now she's not only was she barren all of her life, but now she is an old woman. And she still has a child. Why? Simply because God said it. Because God said so, and she believed God. Praise the Lord. God made covenant with us by his faithfulness, not our faithfulness. This covenant that we have isn't based on our faithfulness. It's based on God's faithfulness. That's why God entered into the covenant with himself, so that we couldn't screw it up. Because if it was left up to us, we would waver. There are times when we're very faithful to God, and there's other times not so much. But God is always faithful. He never changes. Amen? Amen. Hebrews chapter 6, I want to read verses 13 through 20. Hebrews 6, 13 through 20. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. It's the only thing that is unchanging is God's word. It's forever settled in heaven. To the degree it's settled on earth is up to us. We have to live it. We have to believe it. We have to act on it. Amen. So when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself. Amen. Saying, surely, blessing, I will bless thee, and multiplying, I will multiply thee. And so after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. For men verily swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation is to them an end of all strife. Wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath. That by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil. Whether the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus, made a high priest forever, after the order of Melchizedek. Praise the Lord. So God's promise, his covenant, goes beyond the ways of men. Praise the Lord. We swear by things and then we don't keep our word. God swore on himself, because there's none greater to swear on. Amen. He gives us perfect confidence in him and full assurance of all that he, the omnipotent, all-powerful, almighty God, has promised to do. So this really is not about us. It's about him. It's about believing that he is who he says he is. It's just believing that God is God and he can do anything. And whatever he has said, that's his purpose, that's his plan, that's his will. It doesn't make any difference what your history is. It doesn't matter what your past experience has been. Whatever God has said is still the truth. You might have other facts that you deal with, but they're just facts. They change. But God does not change. He heals. He delivers. Amen. He raises the dead. He prospers. He gives wisdom and intellect. He leads us and guides us into all truth. That's what God does. And he can't do anything else because that's who he is. He bound himself by a covenant as if he couldn't be trusted. You know, we used to have the old saying, my word is my bond. Just a handshake was enough. Well, now you got 50,000 pages of legal documents and everything else, and people still try to get out of it. But God treated himself, concerning us, as though he were not trustworthy. His word should have been enough. He should have just been able to say, this is it, believe it, and that's it. But instead of that, he actually enters into a covenant with himself. Praise the Lord. So as if he were not faithful, as if he were dishonest or something, and the only reason was to get us to believe, to get us to see it on a human level. Amen? Beginning with Adam, all that God wanted was for men to believe in him. The very first miracle, the first work of God, was to get men to believe. Wherever God has found faith, he can do anything. Some of us have seen it in our own lives. Certainly we find a history of it in the Bible, but we've experienced it. Most of us have experienced something that somebody had told us it can't happen. The doctor said it. You know, the lawyer said it, the community said it. Somebody has declared something and you're going, oh my God, what? But God has told us something else. And God overrode everything else and made it happen because he's God. Yes. And he can do it every single time somebody believes. Every time somebody believes, it happens. Yes. Praise God. God's grace awakens and it strengthens faith by the covenant. This covenant we're in is the covenant of grace. It's the dispensation of grace. It's a time where God deals with us strictly based on his goodness. Declares us to be righteous, amen, and then operates as though we were perfect as Jesus. And in fact, we are because he said we are. This is a good example because we look in the mirror and we know our day-to-day, moment-by-moment existence and we know that it's not perfect. So we want to measure things by reason. But God said, don't do that. This isn't reasonable. Not from a human perspective. It's unreasonable, but it's the truth because I've said it's the truth. You are the righteousness of God in Christ. Therefore, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Praise the Lord. All that God has promised happens. It comes to pass. It's worked out in the people that He has entered into covenant with. That would be us. Covenant, more than anything else, is to give us a hope in God. A hold on God, a link to God that brings expectation and belief. That's why He did it. So only God would be our portion. So only God would be our strength. So only God would be our resource. So we wouldn't trust in man. So we wouldn't trust in our own ability. So we wouldn't trust in what the lawyer says, what the doctor says. We wouldn't trust in what everybody else says, what the financial people say. We would trust in God. Because no matter what happens everywhere else, God is still God. Still faithful. He'll still do what He has said He's done. And will continue to do. Galatians chapter 4, verses 22 through 24. For it is written that Abraham had two sons, one by a bondmaid, the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh. But he of the free woman was by promise. Which things are an allegory? For these are the two covenants. The one from Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar. So you've got two covenants. And there's two types of the two covenants. The spirit of bondage and the spirit of liberty. But those spirits weren't only in Abram's home. They also existed in God's home, the temple. The priests in the temple couldn't have access to God. Once out of the year, the high priest was able to enter in. And then it was, maybe I'll come out and maybe I won't, depending on how perfect he had been in terms of his sacrifices and confessions and so on and so forth. So it even existed in God's own home. They didn't have the liberty of access into God's presence. But what we read earlier was that Jesus went before us through the veil and gave us access to God. Gives us, the right to come boldly to the throne of grace, to believe that God will do what God has said He's done, not based on what we do, but based on what He has already declared. Luke chapter 5, verse 17 through 21. I know the book of Luke is still actually under the law. The law is still in effect at this point because Jesus hasn't died, hasn't been crucified, hasn't been buried and resurrected. But yet, Jesus is showing us stuff all the time about the kingdom is at hand. It's coming. Get ready. Things are changing, and I'm trying to prepare you for the change that's going to come. And the first thing that He does is try to show us, reveal to us that God is good. That God isn't this angry God that's out to get everybody the way it looks under the law. So I'm going to give you a better covenant. I'm going to give you a better revelation of God. A clearer, more precise revelation of God. That God is good, that God loves, that God wants to forgive, that God is merciful. Amen? So it came to pass on a certain day as He was teaching that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. And behold, men brought in a bed a man which was taken with a palsy, and they sought means to bring him in and to lay him before him. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in because of the multitude, they went up on the housetop, let him down through the tiling with his couch into the midst before Jesus. And when He saw their faith, He said unto him, man, thy sins are forgiven thee. And the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? Praise God. The power, the scripture says, was present to heal them, the scribes and the Pharisees. But none of the Pharisees or scribes were healed. Because it was a question of believing or reasoning. And they reasoned among themselves. This isn't right. This isn't possible. This isn't normal. Amen? Luke 5, verse 21 through 26. The scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, "Who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone?" But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answered and said unto them, "What reason ye in your hearts? Whether it is easier to say, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Rise up and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins, he said unto the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, Arise and take up thy couch, and go into thine house. And immediately he rose up before them, took up that wherein he had laid, and departed to his own house, glorifying God. And they were all amazed, and they glorified God, and were filled with fear, saying, We've seen strange things today." Praise the Lord. What they saw was God. What they saw was what God has always been, what God has always declared to be. But because they reasoned that this doesn't fit our image, they didn't get anything. But one guy who was incapable of getting to Jesus on his own, somebody drops him through a hole in the roof, and immediately he gets healed just because he believed enough to let them drag him up on the roof and drop him into the house. And all these others, with all their intellect, with all of their scriptural knowledge, got nothing but angry and frustrated because it didn't happen the way they thought it ought to happen. Praise the Lord. And I'm just telling you this morning, God, the same God who forgives your sins is the God that heals you. They're the same. That's what Jesus is trying to get across here. There's no difference. You're forgiven and you're healed. Yes. It happened at the same time. It's a question of what we believe. Uh-huh. Praise the Lord. All right, Luke 5, 36 through 39. Because this is immediately following this interaction here that Jesus goes into this talking about mixture. And he says, "He spake also a parable unto them, No man putteth a piece of a new garment upon an old. If otherwise then both the new maketh a rent, and the piece that was taken out of the new agreeth not with the old." In other words, you can't put a piece of new fabric on an old fabric and sew it together because it'll pull apart. One is already shrunk. And the other one hasn't. So they'll age at a different rate and, of course, pull everything apart. "No man putteth new wine into old bottles, else the new wine will burst the bottles and be spilled, and the bottles will perish," because the new wine hasn't completely turned to wine yet. There's a process going on with gases and so on and so forth, and it'll expand and blow the bottle apart, the bag, whatever. Amen. "New wine must be put into new bottles, and both are preserved. No man also, having drunk old wine, straightway desireth new, for he saith the old is better." He was talking to these Jews. He wasn't just telling us about mixture. He was telling them, your problem is because all you've known is the old covenant. You got a problem when I come bringing a new revelation, a greater revelation, a fuller revelation, because you prefer what you've always used. You prefer what you've always understood. You prefer what you have always been accustomed to. And that's where the church is in many ways. We're comfortable with what we've always had. So when God comes along and tries to tell us it's by grace you are saved and not by yourself, it's not of works that any man should boast, we say amen, and then we struggle with it because we have conformed to the idea of a mixture. Of yes, I was saved by grace, but now I got to do some stuff in order for God, amen, to still be my friend, for God to still love me and to provide for me. Praise the Lord. I've learned something in my years, amen. Not a whole lot, but a couple of things. I always say, you know, you learn by your mistakes, and I won't live long enough to get that smart because I don't have time to make enough mistakes to learn everything I need to learn. But I have learned a few things, and one of those things is the more options, the more mediocrity. In other words, we meet resistance, we just move on to the next option. And God has told us there is one way. He is the way, the truth, and the life. There's not options, because if you had options, you end up in mediocrity. You end up with really nothing. You end up with this mixture that doesn't produce anything. He's the answer. He's the way. He's the healer. He's the deliverer. He is the one that will prosper us and bless us. But the focus needs to be on Him. It's not a crapshoot. It's just you don't get, you know, like three rolls here to hit, you know, your seven or make your number. This is it. Yep. Hebrews 11 and 1. Now faith is, this is what we always call this a definition of faith. It's really not a definition of faith. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. That's really not faith. It's the result of faith. Right. Faith is this. Matthew chapter 9, verse 21. For she said within herself, if I may but touch his garment, I'll be healed. I'll be whole. Yeah. That's faith. She just believed, if I can just touch him, I'm healed. Yeah. That is faith. Yeah. If you just believe what he said, God calls that faith. He declares you righteous because of it. And you can get everything that God has promised just by that. Romans chapter 10, verse 9. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. That's what he says faith is. If you believe what he said, you agree with it, it's done. Yes. You just got a miracle. Yes. You just got the greatest miracle possible. Yes. And all you did was believe what God said was the truth. Yes. That's all you did. That's all any of us did to get saved. Right. See, there's two classes of Christians. And those two classes of Christians aren't just found in Galatians. They're throughout the church. It doesn't make them unsaved. Paul dealt with it. He was trying to get them to understand the same thing he's trying to get us to understand by the Holy Spirit. Some are content with a double life. New wine, old wineskins. New covenant, old covenant. Half spirit, half flesh. Half grace, half self-effort. See, I mean, I'm not arguing against the old covenant. The old covenant was absolutely critical. It was vital. It was indispensable to awaken men to their desires. To the idea of us calling on our efforts. And it brings us to a place where it deepens the sense of dependence on God. That's what it was for. To make us see, we can't do this. I've got to depend on God. I've got to depend on a God that loves me in spite of me. Because I'm never going to measure up to God's standards on my own. No matter how much I want to, I can't do it. That's what the law was for. To bring us to the end of ourselves, to get us to see, I need a good God. I don't need a God that's good sometimes and angry other times. I need a God that's love all the time, a God that's going to be merciful to my unrighteousness and my sins he will remember no more. Yes. All right, Galatians chapter 3, verses 23 and 24. I'm saying all this because not just so we have more theology, but so that we operate the way we are supposed to operate. So that we function as the body that we really are, that we were all talking about here. Yes. Capable of doing whatever it is we need to do. You know, here's the other thing I think. Sometimes I'm the nose. Sometimes I'm an ear. Sometimes I'm a foot. Sometimes I'm a hand. Sometimes I'm a mouth. We all are. It isn't like, well, I'm a nose, I'm forever a nose. All I do is smell. It isn't like I'm an ear and all I ever do is hear. Sometimes you're a mouth. Sometimes you speak. Sometimes you walk. Sometimes you lay hands on the sick. Everybody has a part to play. And yes, we have different motions and members at different given times, but we have the capacity to be all of it in any given time whenever the demand is placed upon us. The Spirit will lead us and guide us into all truth so that we can function as whatever it is we're supposed to. See, I don't always need my feet. Sometimes I'm just sitting around, but I want to, you know, dinner's on the stove. I need a nose. I want to smell what's cooking. Amen. I need the mouth. I got to eat. I want to eat. I don't need all every other thing. I just need a hand and a mouth. Or maybe two if I'm really hungry. Right? I don't function. Every part of my body isn't constantly functioning. Amen. But when I need the specific function of specific parts of my body, it's critical that they operate, that they work. So when I'm in a situation where it demands me to lay hands on somebody and pray for them to be healed, I don't need everything else. I just need to do that. If I just need to share the love of God with somebody, I don't need all the other manifestations. I just need to be willing to say what God has said.
Amen.
What's true, right?
Amen.
Okay, so but before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up under the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith.
Right.
Well, the law has done its job as far as we're concerned. The law is still in effect because it's for everybody outside of Christ. They still need this. They still need to be brought to Christ. We don't. We're already there. We've been justified by faith. Now the question is, are we going to operate from the position or not?
Right.
Amen. Here's the question. Is it possible for God to do what He has promised? I don't think anybody in here would question that. Right?
Right.
He can do what He said He'd do.
Absolutely.
Amen. One part of the promise we believe, the complete, perfect pardon of sin.
Yeah.
Right? Well, why not believe the other part? Meeting all of our needs according to His riches in glory.
Yes.
It's just as relevant. It's just as true.
Yes.
We've been so used to separating what God has joined together. See, the objective or the outward work of God in flesh, Jesus. That's part of it. And then there's the subjective or the inward work of the Spirit. It's all by grace. It's all part of the covenant. It's all the same as far as God's concerned. We have focused on the one and kind of, well, we lean on the other occasionally, but we're more believing for the one, that our sins have been forgiven. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, 7 through 10. I don't want my testimony to be, if I can be of any help, you're in way worse trouble than I thought. You know, I don't want somebody coming to me with bad brakes, and all I can tell them is, hey, I made your horn louder. You're not going to stop any faster, but you can let people know you're coming at least. That's where we have gotten to.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. If the ministration of death written and engraven in stones was glorious, the law, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious or more glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect by reason of the glory that excelleth. In other words, that which was made glorious, really, in comparison, is what he's saying, hadn't any glory. Even though it was glorious, when you compare it to the New Covenant,
exactly,
the glory is, it's nothing,
right,
in comparison, amen, by reason of the glory that excelleth.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. See, we've believed the glory of the New Covenant over the old covenant was mainly in the redemptive work of Christ for us and not the Spirit in us. Now, I'm not taking anything away from what he's done for us. But what he did for us was he did something in us at the very same time. And our focus has been on the what he did for us rather than what he has done in us. That's what he's talking about here. Because if this ignorance and unbelief in the Holy Spirit in us, Christ in you, the hope of glory that he's talking about, this more glorious thing.
Yes.
Amen. It's as Christ in us as the power which God fulfills the new covenant promises.
Yes.
Does that make sense to you? They're not all fulfilled because I got my sins washed away. It's the power of God in me, it's Christ in me that fulfills all those promises, that makes all those promises come to pass. It's not the fact that I don't have sin anymore, it's the fact that because I don't have any sin anymore, God can be in me, so that therefore God can work through me. Sin was not the issue. The issue was our disconnect from God. Sin had to be dealt with so that we could be one with God again, so that God could operate through us the way he always wanted to. We make it just about the sin and forget about why he did that. What he did with the sin was simply to make a manifestation of him in us. So that God's power could once again, his glory could once again be revealed on this earth. And he told us, and I believe this to be the fact, that in the last days, darkness and gross darkness will fill the land. Open up your baby blues, look out there, or your browns or your greens or whatever you got, hazel eyes, and recognize darkness is all around us, praise the Lord. But I'm telling you, God has made a promise, and his word is true, that his light will shine brighter, amen, than it ever has before within all the darkness. Because the church is going to understand that what he did was not just take away my sins. What he did was come to live in me and through me so that he could be manifest in this earth. So that the whole world could see the glory of God fill the earth as the waters cover the sea. I've got to say praise the Lord to that. Praise God. Hallelujah. See, it's the Spirit of grace. We don't really expect them to be made true to us, these promises. Because we're not recognizing what the totality of what God has done in us. We keep waiting for God. And I know it's cliche, but God is waiting for us. He has empowered us to believe. We have to turn from all of our past experiences. All of our failures caused by nothing but unbelief. And you can say, well, that's really not fair, Nathan. I can't help it. I don't like it any more than you do. But if his word is true, then the only consequence to it not coming to pass has to be my unbelief. It cannot be the will of God. It cannot be God's powerlessness. It can't be God's diminished abilities in this last day. There can only be one answer. The church hasn't believed. Not consistently.
Right.
Let's just admit completely what failure has taught us. The absolute impossibility of even a regenerated man or woman to walk in God's law in their own strength. And turn to our covenant God. Hear what he says, what he will do for us, and just believe him.
Yes.
Rest in his unchanging faithfulness, the surety of his covenant, his power working in us.
Yes.
That's the covenant.
Yes, it is.
God wants to prove that what he has done for us in Christ is no more amazing that what he wants to do in us and through us by the Spirit of Christ.
Yes.
We're settling for half of the gospel.
Yes.
We're not operating in the totality of what he purchased for us. our oneness with God, a trip beyond the veil and into the presence of God, one with God. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 5 and verse 20. And we don't have to be weird to do it.
No.
Any weirder than we already are. Whatever weirdness we have, we all have our own weirdness, but I'm just saying, whatever we are, whoever we are, we have this ability, we have this power.
Exactly.
In earthen vessels, we have this chained lightning, if you will, that wants to be released.
Uh-huh.
Amen. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Praise the Lord. All right, chapter 6 and verse 14. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. What is sin? Unbelief. Sin isn't the acts. Sin isn't the stuff that people do. Sin is not believing. The other stuff is a result of not believing. Sin's what he's talking about here is unbelief. He's not talking about, you know, somebody got drunk or somebody cussed somebody out or somebody did this. Those are all not, you know, good things. But that's not sin. That's not the sin God's worried about. The sin is not believing God. I had this crud, I don't know what it was, here a week ago, and I had a runny nose, coughing and carrying on. That wasn't what I had. That was a symptom. I could do stuff to cover up the symptoms, but the problem was I still had the problem.
Right?
I mean, we all know that. You get colds, you get different things and so forth and so on. We take stuff. It doesn't cure it. Doesn't even promise to cure it. Just tells you you won't be as uncomfortable. Because we'll mask all the runny nose and the hacking and the coughing and all the stuff that makes you socially undesirable. Praise the Lord for that time. Right? Right? And that's what we've done. We're just dealing with symptoms instead of understanding that God isn't interested in the symptoms. He's interested in the problem. And the problem is our disconnect from Him. The new covenant is entirely a covenant of grace. Like it or not, that's the fact. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18. Personally, I like it. I don't totally understand it, but I like it because the other thing wasn't working for me. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of His calling and what the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints. This is Paul's prayer by the Holy Spirit for us, that the eyes of our understanding, that we would get revelation, that we would be enlightened, so that we would know what really He's calling us for. What is the hope of His calling? What is His expectation for this call to us? And what the riches of the glory of His inheritance is in the saints.
Yes.
We are the glory of His inheritance. It's in us. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Yes.
It's the power of God in earthen vessels. It's a replication of Jesus Christ over and over and over and over and over again. God in flesh. I'm not God, but I got God in this flesh. If I don't, I'm not born again. And so do all of us. In spite of our fleshly dysfunction. So the devil operates by the law to keep us focused on the physical dysfunction rather than focusing on the God that's in behind the veil.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. He doesn't come to you and say, you know, you're not that bad a guy. You know, I mean, come on. No, what He says is, who do you think God's going to use you? You reprobate? You idiot? No, I didn't say that, but I thought it. No, I didn't punch him in the face. I just went away wishing somebody would. Because if I did, it would be in the paper. It wouldn't look good. And it would give all the unbelievers more ammo. Amen. But everything in me wants to just do stuff that I shouldn't do. Now, I don't, partly because of self-discipline and partly because of fear. Because I don't want to go to jail. Too old. Praise God. Any sentence would now be a life sentence. You know what I'm saying? Praise God. So I got to keep it together. Amen. But you know what I'm talking about. That's the whole Sermon on the Mount. So, well, I don't do that. No, but you'd like to. There, maybe not all of it, but there are some things you would have liked to done, or you would like to do, or you'd like to say, or you'd like to get even. And he says you're guilty. Not because you didn't do it, but because you wanted to do it and didn't do it. It's a heart thing. Praise God. That is supposed to be a manifestation of the riches and the glory of that grace. And by grace working in us, all of its promises can be fulfilled and experienced. Remember? He said the glory of this makes the glory of that not even glorious. Even though it was glorious, the comparison is such that it looks like nothing in comparison. And that's what Paul's trying to get us to understand. That's the revelation he wants us to have. All of its promises can be fulfilled and experienced by those who believe. All of them. John 1:14. Wake up, he said, you that slumber. Wake up to what? Wake up to power of God that's in you. Eyes to see, ears to hear. Let's do it. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. I want you to look at that again. We read it all the time. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. How were we saved? By the Word of God. How does faith grow? By the Word of God. Who is the Word of God? Christ is the Word of God. We have him in us. He leads us and guides us into all truth. The Word still works here and in here. Because you know, there's been times, I'll bet you can tell me, that there's been times when you have witnessed to somebody or talked to somebody who had an issue or a situation or circumstance, and you didn't have a scripture, but you said something that was in direct parallel to what the Word of God says. Now, it might not have been verbatim, it might not have been word for word, but it was the principle by which God wanted to speak into their heart. Now, the scripture might not have meant anything to them anyway, but the purpose, the reason for it is all that's necessary. And that's what the Holy Ghost does. We want to know the scripture. But even when you don't know the Word of God, God will use the Word of God in you to speak to somebody about things that you can't quote from the Bible, that you can't give them a chapter and verse for.
Right.
But it's still Bible. It's still the Spirit of God ministering through you. Amen. It's the Word of God. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen. Drop down to verse 16. And of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. What we just said about him, he's saying we have received that same fullness. What, how? God's in us. The same as he was in Christ.
Yes.
He's now in us.
Yes.
And of that fullness, we've all received. The fullness of the Godhead dwells in me bodily. Mm-hmm. The beauty of it and the miraculousness of it is that he does the same thing in all of you. Because there's no limit to God. He can be fully in every one of us all the time. And all we have received, and grace for grace. By grace for grace. Nothing else. What law demands, grace supplies. It's just the way it is. All right, let's go back to Mark chapter 5, and we'll read verses 25 through 34, Sheila. Mark 5, 25 through 34. And a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years and had suffered many things of many physicians and had spent all that she had and was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse. When she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. Remember, this is the gal that we talked about in the beginning. This is what real faith is. if I can just touch him, I'll be healed because he's the healer. All I need to do is touch him. So she came in the press behind and touched his garment, for she said, if I may but touch his clothes, I shall be whole. That's faith. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing that in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned to him about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? And his disciples said unto him, you see the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, who touched me? And he looked around about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, daughter, covenant. That's what he's talking about here. A daughter of Abraham. You're a part of the covenant. You have a right. Amen. Thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. All she had going for her was a covenant. She may not have been able to define it. She may not have been able to preach about it. But she knew, if I can just touch him, I can be healed. Jesus called that faith. She just believed that she had a right simply because she was a daughter of Abraham, a descendant. And Jesus said, that's what healed you. You believed. He didn't turn around and say, well, come on, everybody here that wants to be healed, get in the line. I'm telling you, you can be healed in a service because Jesus is in the service.
Yes.
If you believe, you can receive it. We don't need prayer lines, although I'm not against them. I'm not against praying for people, but you know I don't do a whole lot of that because it ends up being about me or whoever's doing the praying. And it's Christ in you that heals. It's God that does the healing. It's God that does the delivering. It's God that does the blessing. It's God that does the prospering. If you can believe. So we know what God's giving means. His giving depends on our taking. If it were anything else, there would be no sickness in the church. I'm not picking on people who are sick. I get sick, okay, so I know. But I'm saying it's because of all of this mixture. It's because of all the confusion. It's because of all of the, you know, thinking it's one thing and it's something else and not realizing that in me is all the power of the universe. The fullness of the Godhead. That's not bragging. That's what He has said. That's what He has declared. God doesn't force spiritual possessions on us. He promises and He gives in the measure that our desire and our beliefs are ready to receive. He's the same. He doesn't go up and down. He's not got one more power for Sally than He has for me. He doesn't have more power for Mike than He has, you know, for Eric. He's the same. It's our desire or our understanding to receive that is the difference. It's the only thing that can be the difference. Because we all have the same fullness. He gives in divine power. We receive it the same way. By the Spirit. The way, you know, when we trust in that power, the gift becomes conscious. It becomes subjective, like I talked about at the very beginning, the difference between Jesus' physical life and the Spirit, right? So when we believe, when we trust in that power, the gift becomes consciously subjective in the Spirit. It's in the Spirit there, right? And physically, objectively, it becomes our possession. You know, does that make sense to you? Do you understand what I'm saying? When we believe it in the Spirit, it's subjective. It's in our mind. It's in our spirit. But when we do that, when we just believe, it becomes objective. It becomes a possession. It becomes something that is real. This is what happens with Jesus. He died. Amen? It was objective. It was physically done. So what do? We do the reverse. We then believe, and it becomes a spiritual reality. All of these other things are the same thing, only we're just doing them the other direction. We're just going the other way, from the inside out. It was always from the outside in before we were born again. Now it's a thing of the heart, the spirit, not the blood pump, but what's inside of us. So we believe in our heart, and we possess it. It's manifest. So, again, believing or reasoning? It's always the struggle. The subjective, the objective. What's real and what's real? Somewhere that it disconnects. Because we know it works because we've had it happen to us and we've had it happen to others, but just not consistently because we're still looking too much on the outside than the reality that is already done, that it's already in us, that it's already accomplished. God's spiritual gifts aren't recognized by sense or reason. They're known by the Spirit. But once we have that, once we know that, then it can become objective. Then it can become a possession. Then it can become a reality, a manifestation. How did, think, I mean, just, I'm not trying to be, you know, strange here, but I'm just saying, think about the whole thing. How did this happen with Jesus? How did Jesus come into this world? By the Spirit of God. God believed it. And it manifested. It became real. It became a possession of the earth, of humanity. The whole creation, God believed. And it was. And we are created in His image. Not because we all look like Him. Because obviously we all look different. But there's something about us that's all the same, and that's the Spirit of God. The spirit of us is identical, and that's how God sees us, and that's how the world needs us.
Yes.
All right, we'll wrap up with a couple more scriptures here. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. 1 Corinthians 2, 9 and 10. Because see, it's not hard. You just got to believe. Too much emphasis on one and not enough on the other. But as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love Him. But God hath revealed them unto us by His Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. Verse 12. See, it isn't sensed by, it isn't known by senses. No, by the Spirit first. It has to come by the Spirit in order for it to become a possession, before it can become a reality. Now we have received not the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. If you don't know what you got, you can't give it to anybody. That's why He's telling us what you got. You got it. And you got it by the Spirit. Now possess it. Believe. Possess it, and then it becomes yours to give away. Jeremiah, last scripture, Jeremiah 32, verses 40 and 41. Jeremiah 32, 40 and 41. See, this would make the Spirit of God function the way it's supposed to function. Now it sounds kind of idiotic, as if it couldn't, but Jesus said Himself, the Spirit was there to heal every one of them. But only one guy gets healed, because he believed. They were thronging Jesus. They were all over Him, trying to get to Him. One woman gets healed. Why? Because she believed. And that reality manifested. It was true of everybody there. But only one believed, if I can just touch him, I can be healed. And it wasn't because she had, you know, more faith than everybody else. It was simply because she believed enough to act on what the Word of God said. She had a right for healing. She had a right to be healed. I will make an everlasting covenant with them that I will not turn away from them to do them good. I'll put my fear in their hearts, a knowledge of me in their spirit. That's what that means. It's not, oh my God, here comes God. But I'll put my fear in their hearts and they shall not depart from me. You can't depart from him. He can't depart from you. I'll never leave you or forsake you. You're one. You may think you've left sometimes because you've done something stupid, but as far as God's concerned, you don't leave and he doesn't leave. This is an everlasting covenant. He has promised it can't be broken. They shall not depart from me. Yea, I will rejoice over them to do them good, and I will plant them in this land assuredly with my whole heart and with my whole soul. That's God talking. The kingdom is yours. It belongs to you. And it's based on God's promise, his whole heart, and his whole soul. Back up that promise. A covenant that will never be done away with. A covenant to do you good and not harm. A covenant that knows that he's in us and for us. So I'll just finish with this. Believe God's word is true. And then you'll experience all the covenant of grace has to offer. That's all there is to it. Just believe it, and it becomes reality. You will experience it. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
I believe he's a good God. Amen. He's a good God that wants to do nothing but good for each and every one of us. If you can believe. All things are possible. Yes. Nothing shall be impossible to them that believe. Give him a hand clap this morning. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate you all being here. Shake hands with one another and tell him, I got the power. Praise the Lord. I am the power. Hallelujah. Christ in you. In Jesus' name. You're dismissed in his perfect name. Amen.